Ever since I was a little kid, I thought bars were this place of mystery. I mean, they have these big lights out front, but you can't really see through the windows. And you open up the door, and it's usually dark inside. And the bar itself is like dark mahogany. And they'd have like the bottles hidden behind the bar. I mean, what is that? No, seriously, what is that?
Oh, well, these are just Yakima Valley bitters. Oh, I've got some Bitterman's burlesque bitters. They're like hibiscus and stuff. I've got Peychaud's out of New Orleans. I've got Regan's orange bitters. They're my favorite of any of the oranges. We got Angostura. Oh, I've even got some bitters that I made myself at home.
It's like a category. It's like a big category. It's lots and lots of bitters. And yes, they add bitterness, but they also are supposed to add depth and complexity to a cocktail. In fact, the notion of bitters is crucial to the very idea of a cocktail. The first time the word cocktail appears in print,
1806, Hudson Valley newspaper.
They say this new cocktail thing is a bittered sling. Now, what does that mean? A sling is sugar and alcohol, and they bittered it. They added bitters to it. And partly because, like Mary Poppins said, sugar makes the medicine go down, and bitters are a kind of medicine, but also to add depth and complexity to the cocktail. Think of it like the way a chef will simmer a stew for hours or even days to add richness and intensity to the stew. That's what a bitter is supposed to do to your cocktail.
I think it's great that America is finally coming around to bitter things, whether it's radicchio, bitters and drinks, whatever it is. We're way behind the rest of the world, but we're catching up. I think bitters, they're really concentrated in flavor and highly sort of acidic, that bitter, obviously. So they work well in stews, any kind of beef stew or lamb stew. Almost like the anchovy, the Italians throw an anchovy in stews. You don't ever find it, you don't ever taste it, but it's that little flavor that adds the depth, layers and layers of flavors.
Just like you do today, centuries ago, people ate and drank what they thought was healthy. You know, whatever leaf or flower or plant they thought would give them healthful benefits. And in fact, in Italy, they would put all those in a concentrated form we call bitters today. In Italy, it seemed like every town, every city, had their own little set of bitters. That's just the way they did it. Today, mixologists are mixing it up, not surprisingly. And so when they make bitters, instead of trying to reflect the plants that grow outside the town's walls, they're often focused on a single flavor, like Dale DeGroff's pimento bitters, or Gary Regan's orange bitters, or how does Berto make bitters?
Well, I would take the solvent, a high alcohol rum or vodka, something like that, herbs, barks, roots, spices, the flavor you're trying to go for, store it in a cold, dry place, agitating it every so often.
Well, when I use the bitters in a cocktail, just like in the kitchen, that one little pinch of salt is going to make or break that that sauce or whatever that you're making. The same goes with bitters. That one little dash of Angostura bitters in that cocktail is going to bind those flavors together into exactly what you're going for.
Bitters essentially is you take aromatic botanicals and you suspend the flavor and chemicals in alcohol. The earliest way is putting roots and barks in wine and letting it sit for a while. A lot of this stuff, classically you use cassia, you use cinchona, you use orange peel, you use bitter barks and roots, but now bartenders can do anything from persimmon bitters to, I got pumpkin spice bitters here. Adding bitters is similar to using salt or seasoning or spices in cooking. You're adding a little dash here or a pinch there to add depth of flavor and harmonize some of the elements. Sometimes a little dash of Angostura just makes a drink that's not quite there kind of come together.
My mentor basically said to me the best way to understand what bitters do for a cocktail is to use them. So he had me make two Manhattans, one with bitters and one without, and I looked at them side by side and I'm like, oh, okay, they look the same. The smell is drastically different, and then I tasted them and it was like a light bulb went off in my head. When you taste the first cocktail that doesn't have bitters in it, it's whiskey, which is very nice, but it kind of falls flat on the palate. It doesn't have a like lingering finish. You swallow and it's done. And then you taste the cocktail that has the bitters in it, and it's got a rounder flavor to it. It softens the edges of that whiskey. You get some of those fall kind of spices in there that's really nice.
The rest of Southern and Mediterranean Europe wasn't really focused on bitters as much as they were on vermouth. Now vermouth, I know it's a wine, but it's a flavored wine, fortified and then flavored with many of the same ingredients that we see here. Yes, I know some people drink vermouth by itself, but really we tend to use it in cocktails. And whether it's bitters or vermouth, these for us really have one purpose only, and that's to make your cocktail taste better. And whether it's a martini, or it's a Manhattan, or it's a Bobby
Byrne,
or a
Bronx.
Uh-huh.
Rob Roy or a Negroni.
All of these have wine in them. Now, one other thing. Any dry vermouth in that?
A little bit in there.
Okay, see, I'm not going to tell you how to make your martini, but if you want a dry martini, I think a little dry vermouth helps. It's not that you wave the bottle over the glass, okay, but dry vermouth has some bitterness to it. You throw it in your martini just a little bit, and it makes your martini drier. But you know what? Everybody's martini is personal, because everybody's taste is different, right? You may have heard of something called cork taint. It actually is something we refer to as a corked wine. Now, don't all wines that have a cork in them, aren't they all corked? No, no, no. Corked is something we use to describe this compound called trichloroanisole 2,4-D, TCA for short. Or we'll just say the wine is corked because it has this smell like old wet newspaper or moldy cardboard or something. And it's actually an invisible mold that grows on newspapers and cardboard and sometimes on corks. And it'll actually make the wine smell not very good as well. And that won't hurt you if you drink it, but if you find yourself tasting a brand new bottle of wine and it has that kind of wet newspaper smell to it, you might want to ask for a different bottle of wine. We'll say that that wine is corked. Now, if a wine has a screw cap and you don't like it so much, do we say the wine is screwed? Perhaps. But let's just stick to the idea of some wines, maybe 1%, are corked.